So, my name is Michael. I work at Keenfolg. We do Linux system level cloud software. You maybe know by now. Who here has used BPF before? Okay, maybe 30%, 25. So yeah, this talk is really focused on the basics, and I hope it helps you to understand the low-level concepts and the language if you want to start with it. I will touch the history a bit and then go over architecture, instruction set, development tools. So what is BPF? Some people describe it as in-kernel bytecode virtual machine, others as engine. So it's a small language that can be used in the Linux kernel for certain tasks. And it has been there for a long time. So today there's classic and extended BPF. And when I say BPF, I mean extended BPF as found in the Linux kernel today. Actually, classic BPF, when used today, is internally translated to extended BPF. So what actually runs is extended BPF. If you have used TCP dump, and probably that's more people than the group of BPF users, you have already used classic BPF. If you haven't seen this talk this morning, it shows how you can get BPF output from TCP dump and so on, and explains a couple of things about classic BPF. So I will skip this part of my presentation and encourage you to just go back to the talk from tomorrow, this morning. So today we have extended BPF. Compared to the classic version, it has a richer instruction set, more features, and more use cases. Most prominent use cases are networking, express data path, tracing. So for example, you can attach BPF programs to trace points or kprobes, which are facilities in the Linux kernel to trace program flows, to debug things. And security. The main design properties are that it's very fast, equal to a native code. There's a JIT compilation in the Linux kernel, and when extended BPF was designed, that was one of the main goals to make the language match how modern systems look today. So, for example, match registers which are available in the in BPF to actual registers of modern CPUs. And another design decision was to make it possible that calls into or from BPF don't have any so-called for-in-function overhead. So your code actually runs in the kernel context. It's a general-purpose instruction set. There are 11 registers. Register 10 is the program counter. And you have 512 bytes of stack, which is not a lot, but it's surprising how much stuff is possible with even such a limited environment. The registers are grouped as follows. The first register is the return value of functions, and it's also used as the exit value of your BPF program. Then there are registers as arguments to in-kernel functions. Registers that are Cauley saved, so you can use those for your stuff, and register 10 holds the frame pointer. eBPF also has maps, so that's for there are different kinds of maps, and maps are key value stores, so when you create a map, you can define what kind of data you want to put in there. And those are also used to make it possible to have interaction between kernel space, so the BPF program that runs in the kernel, and the user space application in user land. So you can use it for both. Either you only use it in your BPF program, or you use it for example to pass data to user land or to read data from user land. So when you think about a firewall, maybe your userland application wants to signal that port 80 should be blocked. So you could have a table which is a list key and blocked or not blocked port. Key is port and a value is a flag for blocked or not blocked. And your program in kernel space could check this map to verify what it should do. Second thing is helper functions. So depending on what type your program has, you have a couple of helper functions by the kernel. So one helper function, for example, is print k. So you can write to a trace pipe. It's not the kernel ring buffer that you can see with dmessage, but there's a tracepipe file in the kernel debug file system, and there you can write messages to. Third thing is tails calls into BPF programs, so you can chain programs. That's really useful when you have complex applications and want to have some kind of waterfall design. So you could load a lot of programs and then decide from your first program which handler should take over the payload. And finally, there's the pseudo file system, BPF file system. So this can be used to pin programs or maps. Usually programs and maps are tied to the lifespan of the process. So when your process dies, the BPF program or the map or whatever you have created is deleted as well. If you pin it to the file system, that won't be the case, but then only when the last reference is gone, the kernel will actually delete the program. And that's also useful for inter-process communication. So again, you can think of some scenario where one application sets up rules, programs, and a second application checks the BPF file system to find out about what is there and to use those. When you have your program, or when you do your BPF call to load a program, the kernel verifier comes into play. So the for all programs that you load, the verifier has to make sure that the program is sane and follows the rules, because you don't want that the program, for example, enters an infinite loop and never exits again. This would mean your kernel is blocked and the system is dead. So there's an instruction limit. The verifier is pretty complicated, so there's a very long comment in the source code, which I can recommend as a documentation, but in my experience, it often still needs back and forth between writing code, trying to load it, getting some cryptic message from the verifier, and trying to find out what's going on. So this can be a bit painful when you are just starting and don't have a feeling yet for what the verifier maybe could be complaining about. All interaction with the eBPF subsystem happens through the syscall BPF. You have the single syscall, and what you actually want to do then is defined in the BPF attribute union. It's a pretty large union today with a lot of fields which can potentially be set. So no matter if you want to load a program or create a map or look up a value of a map or delete a map or whatever, you always use the system call, and you have to set the proper fields in the attribute corresponding to what you want to do get it done. So all that together, the big picture could look like this. So this is a use case where we attach a kprobe to a kernel function. So it would similar like this, look similar like this. It starts with a program that you write. You can use LLVM to translate it to an ELF file. LLVM has a backend for BPF. So that's pretty useful because, as we will see in a moment, writing BPF pseudo-assembly is not so easy and nice. And once you have this program, you can load it with the syscall. The verifier will check it, and if it's okay, it will be loaded. And then in the kprobe scenario, the kernel will trigger whenever the kernel function which the program was attached to is accessed, and your program can, for example, write to maps, and the user space application again can also interact with those maps. So before we look at a program written in C, I will show you how BPF instructions look low level. So this is a very simple program that does nothing except returning 11. So what we do here is we write the immediate value 11 into register 0. We have learned before register 0 is also the return value of your program, and then we exit the program. And that's actually the most minimal program you can write in BPF. Having only an exit instruction would not work because the verifier would reject the program, as only values can be read that have been written before. This is to protect kernel memory. And the exit instruction reads the value in register 0, so we have to write to it before. If we would want to load this program, we could do it like this. So we take this BPF attribute union and set a couple of fields. First, I set the program type. In this case, where we have this demo program, it doesn't really matter. But of course, if you write your real applications, you have to choose what you want to do. Then we give the size of the program, we give the instructions, and we also set the license. We do set the license because the kernel will not allow us to access a couple of things like helper functions if it's not GPL licensed. You can compare that to what you maybe know from Linux modules. There you also have to declare what is the license of the module. And then finally, we can load the program, and we do this with proc load. We pass the previously defined attribute, and if the call is successful, we get back a file descriptor. If not, the value will be negative, and you have to handle it. So how does such an instruction look like? It has five fields. First is the opcode, one byte, so what do you want to do? And then destination register, source register, offset, and immediate constant. And it depends on what kind of operation you do. You don't always need all the fields, of course. If you want to write an immediate constant into the destination register, like we have done in our program, we would only set destination register to register 0 and immediate to 11. We don't have to set the other fields. The opcode is actually a mix of fields. So the define for the move instruction that we have used before looks like this. First, we say we want to move a value. We then say BPF k, and this is goes back to classic BPF days. In this context, it means we want to move an immediate value, because BPF k was the same in classic BPF, and there's another flag which would mean we want to use a source register. So when we have these three things in mind, those are operation code, source bit, and instruction class. There are two types of opcode encodings, as you can see, so it depends on which instruction you use. So if you would have a load and store instruction, it's 2 bits, because you have more options what the source or the size could be. Here it's only immediate or source register. Here it's half word, word, double word, and so on. So that's why we need more bits here. Then there's the verification log. You need the log to figure out what the verifier thinks about your program. So I would just always set this, and when you do, and there's in, it's large enough, that's important, then you get back the verifier log, and this exactly tells you what the verifier has been seen in your program, what was loaded, and if there's an error, also what is the problem with your application. If you would set the level only to 1, you wouldn't get those register dumps after each instruction. So you have to decide if you need this. I've said this before, some programs must match some programs must match the kernel version. Kprobe programs must do this, because the data types that are passed to the probe are version specific, so fields and offsets could change. So you have to tell the kernel, yes, I want to run this program on this version, basically guarantee that it will work. We have seen maps before, so there are different types of maps. I think it's between 10 and 20 today. One special type of map is the proc array. It's a lookup table for other BPF programs which are loaded, so you can use a proc array to, for example, create a list of programs, of handler programs, and then from if you want to chain programs, you can make the first program look up or tail call a program from a proc array. And I've also already said user space, kernel space, data passing is what is done with maps. Map definition could look like this. So you have the type, you have a key size and a value size, and maximum number of entries. Actually, there are more fields today, and it also depends a bit on what loader is loading the map. So for example, TCBPF, it's also BPF, able to load BPF handlers for traffic control. And they have a field which allows you to pin a program to a namespace. LLVM learned about BPF in version 3.7. That one is important. You need to inline everything, and you best define a macro, because inline alone doesn't force the compiler to inline code. So you should set attribute always inline. Only then you can be sure that the compiler does inline the code. You can do printk debugging. Clang allows you to add 12 info. That's nice because you can object dump your object after build and compare to what the kernel verifier gave you back in the verifier log. And since the object dump is C code annotated, you can get at least a clue where the problem is in your program. I have only about 4 minutes left, so maybe I have to rush through things a bit. So I will give you a quick demo. So here I have a rather simple and stupid program which does count syscalls. For that, I use a BPF program that gets attached to the raw syscall sysenter. And every, no matter which syscall you use, this trace point will trigger every time. And since this is too much to output, I limit it to the read syscall, which has the ID 3. And I will just start this. I do this for only a single PID. So this is this bash here. You can see the PID is the same as here. And when I do things here, we can see the read syscalls are detected. So I did this with for the BPF program, I used LLVM to translate it to an ELF object. And for the user space part, I used GoBPF and a small tool to load the program. You could also use BCC. I would especially recommend it when you just want to start playing with it because it's very major already and a lot of tools are in the repository. It's very popular and it has very nice Python and Lua bindings which make it really easy to use BPF for tracing purposes. They also have a nice list about which Linux version introduced which BPF feature. So that's the best place to go if you have to find out if you can use a feature on the kernel that is in your Linux distro, for example. BPF proc test run is great, available since Linux 4.12. And with that, you can use your SKB and XDB programs and give them to the kernel and provide data which will then be passed to the program as packet data, so it's possible to unit test your programs without having, for example, network hardware which is capable of running BPF programs. So this would look like this. You again fill the BPF attribute, the test part, with your program. You call it, and if set, you get the data, how the network packet, for example, looked like after it was handled by your handler, the return value, and the duration. So that's pretty nice because that's not something which was possible before. So you had to set up your virtual network infrastructure environment and then start programs and intercept the traffic. And with that, you can test the handlers alone and just pass in a socket buffer. There are a couple of sysctl options. If regarding tracing, there's an excellent resource by Brandon Craig. And there are a couple of projects which are prominent users of BPF, so there's a lot of to learn in the source code. The talk this morning was about TCP tracer BPF, actually. And that's it. Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
Would you say that eBPF is suitable for modifying packets if they go through the kernel?
Yes, you can modify packets. I don't know out of my head which program type you have to choose, because I mostly do tracing and don't have real experience with networking. But I think most users actually use it for networking. But you have to look up the details. I don't know. More questions? Okay, thank you.